Hey everybody, Bill 1911 here. Hey, today we're going to look at an interesting little pistol. This is a Taurus model 85, okay? This particular piece is hammerless. In other words, there is no spur on the hammer. Now this becomes advantageous if you're carrying this as a concealed carry permit because there's nothing to hang on your clothes as you draw the revolver from your holster. So it's an interesting little gun, and it shoots very well. It's actually a pretty nice little piece. This one I carried for quite some time, and as you can see, it's pretty banged up, but got a lot of scratches and stuff on it. But this was a workhorse. It did a very good job for me. So as is always the case, we're going to verify that there is no ammunition in the gun. All right. We are also going to verify that there is no ammunition in the work area, okay? It's a safety precaution, and it's well worth taking, in my opinion. So, I'd like to apologize. My gun cleaning mat here is getting a little dirty, so we're going to do something about scrubbing that in the next couple of days after I get a second one to replace it. So, let's get started, okay? We're going to need a couple things to do the job. We're going to need a cleaning solvent, and we're also going to need gun patches, and we are going to need a gun oil. Okay, so this is a bore cleaning solvent. This is military surplus. I bought it because there was a lot of it, and it was very inexpensive. So, I always recommend that we use a specifically designed, in other words, specifically formulated gun oil, okay? Some guns have some plastic parts in them. This one does not. There are no plastic parts in this gun. A lot of people like to use WD-40 because it's aerosol and it washes things out very quickly and very effectively. In truth, I've never heard of anybody having a problem with WD-40 causing any of the plastic parts in the gun to go bad. I have seen other instances where plastic parts in other types of machines were damaged by contact with oil. So it is possible for it to happen. When the firearms manufacturers design these things, they know what you're going to be using for gun oil. And they formulate their parts, the plastic in their parts, so that they are compatible with gun oils. As I was saying about WD-40, I've never actually heard of anybody having any problem with it, so I don't think it's an issue, but again, you don't know until after you put the oil on the plastic part whether it's going to damage it or not. Okay, so this one is going to be a fairly short video because there just isn't that much to this gun. It's a pretty simple piece. We're going to need a cleaning jag. Now, personally, I like cleaning jags. I think they do an excellent job. You need the right size for the right gun. This kit has pretty much everything I need since I clean a lot of different guns. I use a lot of different jags. So, let me put this back in the kit, one I'm not using. All right, so on the tip of the jag, you will find a little point right here. Now this little point is used to stab through the gun patch and hold it in place on the jag. Alright, so to get started on the cleaning, first thing we're going to do is wet our patch in solvent. And then we're going to start cleaning everywhere where we can find on the outside of the gun. Okay, get everything cleaned up there. And you're going to find that you've got little dirt deposits in places that you may not have expected to see them. But they're going to be there. Especially on the front side of the cylinder. The reason why there is because as you fire the gun, gases escape between the barrel and the cylinder, okay? And they take with them little bits of burnt powder, carbon, things like that. And it kind of gets in just about everything. So we're going to get everything wetted down with our patch and let that solvent start working on that carbon and other material that's in these little tiny corners and crevices. Okay. And as is always the case, you're going to get a good bit of dirt out of it. So we just continue the process. I'm going to use this little implement to get down in here and just push that patch in, rub it around a little bit, okay, clean everything out. Sometimes it's difficult to get into some of these small corners and crevices, so it's always advantageous to have a cleaning brush of some kind, okay? You can use a toothbrush, an old toothbrush. Again, if you're going to use it on your gun, don't try to use it on your teeth again after using it to clean your guns, because this solvent is very, very poisonous. So, like I said, we're going to get things all cleaned up. Now, one of the things that sometimes happens on these guns is that you'll find that screws here and there actually come loose, okay? So it doesn't hurt to have a small screwdriver handy just to double check and make sure that these screws are in fact tight. And they all look good. Okay? I didn't check the grip. All right. There we go. So, a long time ago, Taurus was kind of a Saturday night special kind of gun. It just wasn't that great a gun. But over time, they've gotten to the point where Taurus, man, they really make a really, really good quality firearm. I own several Tauruses, and I really like them. They're good guns. So we're going to continue. Get everything out we can get out. If you can see it, try to scrub it. All right, so that looks good. Now, funny thing, when you carry a gun on your person, one of the things that happens a lot is that you get stuff down inside the action of the gun that would surprise you. I mean, hair off your body, you get fibers out of your clothing, dead skin gets down in there, everything gets down into that darn gun. You'd be surprised at what all gets in there. So when you're carrying a gun, make sure that you clean it about once a week. I wouldn't go any longer than that, particularly if it's a semi-automatic. Revolvers like this one are much more tolerant of neglect. That said, don't neglect them. Make sure that you keep them clean. Because if you ever have to use one, if you're ever in a situation where it's life or death, you don't want to be in a position where you get one shot off and then you start saying, oh crap. I mean, that's not a good thing. So make sure that you do your maintenance. Clean your gun regularly, okay? Now, in just a few days, we're going to do a video on actually how to carry a gun, how to physically carry the gun. And there's just dozens and dozens of different options. Some like to carry it in the small of their back. Some like to carry it in a holster on their hip. Some ladies like to carry them in their purse. Some people have belly bags around their tummy where they put them. There's dozens of different options. So we're going to discuss all that, and we're going to discuss some of the legal ramifications involved. But that's for another video. So, now we're going to get to cleaning the bore on this gun. In other words, down the inside of the barrel. So we're going to stab that jag through our patch. Okay. And then we're going to work it in through the gun. So, with a jag, it's a very, very tight fit through that barrel. So now the barrel was actually very, very clean on this. There was almost nothing in it, so that's very good. All right, but we're also going to clean all of the chambers. Now this is a 5-shot revolver, so there's not a lot that you're going to have to clean here. It's pretty darn simple. All right, so all right, we got a little crud out of that, so we're going to wet another patch. And the type of patches I use are flannel, and they're what they call double nap flannel. Now, what is double nap? Okay, both sides of the patch are fuzzy. Single nap flannel, you'll find the fuzzy part on one side, but you go on the other side and there's no fuzz. The reason why I like the double nap is because I can clean one chamber with it, okay, and then turn it inside out, remount it on my jag, and clean a second chamber without changing the patch out. So I ran the bore with one patch, and I ran the first of the 5 chambers with the other side of that first patch. So now we're going to mount another patch, and we're going to do 2 more chambers. Okay. That's the first one. And we're going to turn it inside out, remount, and do the second one. All right, so keep track of which cylinders you have cleaned and which ones you have not cleaned. What I like to do is I simply rotate the next one to be done up to the top position where I can see which one it is, okay? That's what I like to do. Everybody has their own system. Just keep track of where you're at. Okay. So. All right. I don't remember. Okay. Yep. So. Here I was telling you not to lose track, and what did I do? I lost track. I was so busy explaining that I lost track myself. I don't like do as I say, not as I do, but in this case, do as I say, not as I did. Oh well, I am human. So, the big key here is just make sure that you don't forget to do all of them. Okay, so I'm confident we've done all of them. Now, the next thing we need to do is get another patch, a dry patch, and we're going to clean the inside, or dry the inside of that bore to make sure that there's no solvent setting in the bore. Now, it's not going to destroy the gun if you forget this step, but we didn't forget it, so we're good to go. Now, after we have cleaned the barrel, we're going to take one of these nice bright white patches, and I'm going to show you what we're going to do with it. Okay, if you look down that barrel, it's very hard to see down in it. Unless we take something very bright, like this white patch, and we reflect that light back up through that barrel, okay? So you see the difference. So, that's exactly how I'm going to inspect this barrel right now. And boy, is that nice and clean, it's beautiful. All right, so, now that we've established that, I'm going to go ahead and dry the chambers on the cylinder up. Okay, that's one. Now, when I dried the bore just a moment ago, I only used one side of the patch. So I still have one more side of that patch that I can use. So that's two chambers dried. Now we're going to turn this guy inside out. And that'll be three chambers dried. And now one more patch for those last two chambers. And we're going to mount that patch right on the jag, like that. And go through and dry those last two chambers. Okay. Turn it inside out and do the other one. Now there is an area on this gun that quite frequently gets kind of left out in revolvers, just because we kind of forget to do it. And that area is underneath the cartridge extractor. Okay, this little piece here, once your cartridges are spent, it pushes them out of the chambers so that you can then pull them out, okay? So underneath this, down in here, sometimes can get pretty dirty. So we do want to get in there and make sure that that's all cleaned out underneath there. Okay. If you have trouble reaching it, okay, there is a little tool that we discussed earlier, and that is a cleaning brush, like this one here. Now, you don't have to go out and buy one of these. A toothbrush will do the job. But the nice thing about these cleaning brushes is that they have some very narrow bristles on one end that make it really easy to get into tight spots. Okay. Okay, so that looks pretty good. Now, I do want to get an area right here at the front of the barrel. Okay, I want to get my brush in there and try and make sure that's as clean as possible. As you do, again, you get a lot of buildup in there. Alright, so once we've got the gun cleaned, now we're going to oil it. And oiling this thing is just pretty darn simple. There are some places that you want to make sure that you don't forget about. And that is that spot that I was just telling you. Okay? Right inside of here. You want to make sure you get a drop of oil in here. Okay? And work it through a little bit. Okay? The same on the other end of the rod where it goes through the crane arm. Now, when you're oiling a gun, you don't want to under-oil the gun, but you don't want to over-oil it either. You don't want it to be so slippery that you can't hang on to it. All right, so you're going to find over time that you're going to discover that there are some high wear places on a gun. In other words, you get a lot of wear. And those are places where metal rubs against metal. Right down inside this little slot that's right here is a part called the push paw or advancing dog. And what that does is on the back of the cylinder right here, there are some little tiny like gears. And that push paw comes up out of that slot, hits those gears, and advances the cylinder to the next firing position, okay? So we're going to want to put some oil on that because this is one of those high traffic areas where there's a lot of wear on the gun, okay? So we want that push paw to have a little bit of oil on it. Again, we're not trying to drown it, okay? So there is another part on these things that's right down here in the bottom of the frame. This is the locking dog. Now what that lock does is when the cylinder comes back to the firing position, I pulled it a little too far, it locks that cylinder into place so that it's aligned or timed with the barrel, okay? So that engages and disengages in all of these spots. So we want to put a drop of oil on that dog as well, all right? We're going to want, definitely, always on the release of a gun, you want to put a drop of oil on that. If that freezes up, you can't get the gun open to load and unload or to clean it. So we definitely want to make sure that that stays free. There are some little parts around the trigger that have high wear that we want to make sure they get some oil as well. Oh, get in there. Okay, there it went. Okay. And I like to put a little, darn it, right down there in the hammer. Now, I got a lot of oil on there, so I'm going to take my rag and clean up the outside of it. Now, the oil has run down beside the hammer, and that's what I wanted it to do, okay? Now, I'm going to manipulate it a little bit. Okay. And that will do that. Okay, so that's about all there is to this little five-shot Taurus 38 caliber model 85. It's a good carry gun because without that little spur on that hammer, it comes out pretty easy. Now, the only problem is that this gun can only be fired double action. In other words, that trigger has to go all the way, full travel, before it's going to pop. All right, that's it. The model. Hey everybody, Bill 1911 here. If you found this video to be helpful and informative, don't forget to like us. And please subscribe. And by all means, come to visit us at askbill1911.com. Also, I want to talk to you about something that's very important to us, and that's your safety. So please, don't try any of the things you see on our videos until you have thoroughly reviewed and understood our safety procedures. If you're under 18 years of age, do not try any of these topics without the express permission of your parent or guardian. Thank you.